the first big section of this class is devoted to exploring ASP.NET controls. And the stuff that you can do to get to provide a framework. All right, so we looked at some of the ASP.NET controls like validation controls and text box controls and drop-down controls that allow you the ability to create your application with a starting point, and certain functionality is already there, so you don't have to worry about it. So with validation is a great example of it, because that's something that like everyone that does a web application is going to need to worry about. And there may be something unique about your particular page in this validation, but you know, a good portion of the validation is very sort of simplistic stuff. In other words, is the form field filled in? Is there something there? Is there a date in the field? Is it within a certain valid range of numbers, and so on? So these validation controls give us the ability to not have to worry about that bit of code. So if we don't have to worry about that bit of code, we can worry about the stuff that's unique and that's distinct to our application. And we then talked about how we can extend that framework for business logic. So we created a couple of things, and we created our own custom classes that allow us to put some business logic in a common place so that it can be used over and over again. Again, reusability, giving a framework, anything that like gives us a little bit of an edge so that we don't have to do everything all by ourselves every single time. We don't have to reinvent the wheel each time is a big benefit. Last class we looked at things, and we started to look at things from the user interface perspective. And the one thing that we observed is that many, many pages, or many, many sites, have a consistent layout. I mean, that's a design goal, right? You don't want your pages to look different, every single page to look different and have a totally different layout. You want it to be very clear that the navigation, if the navigation's on the left side, it's on the left side. If the sub-navigation is on the right side, it's on the right side. If your contact information's on the bottom of the page, it stays on the bottom of the page. So therefore, a consistent look and feel is something that is very valuable in websites. And certain parts of that are achieved via CSS. So like the look and feel of the layout, of the color scheme, of the fonts and all that, are CSS things. But there's certain common content that belongs, or that is in HTML. And we want some reusability as far as that goes too. We want to be able to create sort of a template HTML page that we can clone. And we can do it such that if we make changes to the common portions of the page, then we don't have to go back and change every individual page. And that brings us to the concept of a master page. A master page, again, is for the common code. So if we have a page, and we developed a page for Grandpa's Cheese Barn that looks sort of like this, where we have a header on the top of the page, a navigation, and a footer, and then we have sort of a common, or we have a content area that gets filled in. It's different on each page. We can develop a master page that contains the common elements. And then all we have to code is the little section here on each distinct page, on each separate page. And that's a big win, because if we choose to change something in the header, we can make that change in one place, and then every place across the application will get that change, and so on. So we started out last time with a simple master page, and we'll look at that again. What I would like to talk about, though, is I would like to talk about nesting master pages. Now, for your project, I wouldn't necessarily worry about doing that, because your project is small enough where you probably do not need nested master pages, all right? But I think it's worth worthwhile to mention that anyhow. All right? And a nested master page is where you have maybe a overall layout for the pages of your site, but then maybe you have subsections of your site that have a slightly different layout. And to include, to extend this, maybe we have some pages on our site where we want, in addition to this basic layout, we want there to be sort of an aside section over here. Maybe we put the top news story on that section. But not every page on the site. Maybe only certain pages on the site we want to have that. Or maybe it's a sub-navigation. We saw the example like on LC's web page where if you go to a certain section of the page, there's a certain sub-navigation. So if you're in one area, the sub-navigation is one thing. If you're in another area, it's something else. So we've seen even on LC's page that there's some common content on every single page. Then certain pages have common content within a subgroup. And that's exactly what you use nested master pages for. So that's what we're going to start out today. We're going to review the concept of a master page, and then we are going to go and make a second master page that is nested, that uses this as its basis, and we then create a brand new page for it. Let me go and open the page that we did last week, and we'll spend a minute to review the master page, then we will nest a master page. So here's the master page that we did last time. And a master page looks just like a basic ASPX page. All right, it is, in other words, a mix of HTML and ASP.NET controls. So we have our HTML tag, we have our head tag, we have our body tag, we have our form tag. You have a header section, H1s, paragraphs, and so on. All right. There's a special ASP.NET control, though, called a content placeholder. And the content placeholder is where the special content that is unique to every individual page belongs. So this represents the thing that I drew on the board with the dashed lines around it. It's the thing that's going to get filled in on every single page. So if we look at my master page, this right here is the content placeholder. So that is where we're going to put the content that's distinct to every individual page. All right? And you get two of them. All right? You get two of them. You get one in the header, one in the head rather, and one in the body. That way, if there's anything special that you want to put on the page as far as JavaScript or CSS or whatever, you can put it in there. All right, because that's going to be in the head section. So the stuff that belongs in the head section, you put there. The stuff that belongs in the body section, you put in this content placeholder. Now, you can put more content placeholders if you see fit. So you don't have to just have one in the head and one in the body. You could have a couple of them in the head, a couple of them in the body, and so on. Alright? If we look at this, this area here represents or actually this area here represents the content placeholder. The other stuff is stuff that is on the master page. Now remember, we can't view a master page in a browser because a master page isn't a completed web page. We can only view ASPX pages. So in order to see this, we have to make pages that implement this master page. And we did that with a couple of them. We'll look at the default page. And we can look at it in design view. And here's what we see. All right. This stuff being coming from the master page, this stuff being part of the page itself, part of the new page that we created based on the master page. Notice the little glyph indicates that we can't change that stuff there because you would have to change it in the master page. On each individual page, I can't change the stuff that comes from the master page. I can change the stuff, though, that is distinct to that page. And if we look at the source for this, we'll see that we don't have a complete HTML page. We simply have two content controls. All right? And those content controls correspond to the content placeholders in the master page. They match up based on ID. So this one is in the head section. This one is called content placeholder 1. And if we look on the master page, that's exactly what we have. Content placeholder with an ID of head. Whatever we put in there sort of gets copied and pasted right in that spot in the master page. And here's content placeholder 1. So now we can run this and we will see the default page, which again is a combination of the stuff that came from the master page and the stuff that's coded distinct for that page. From the user's perspective, a user visiting the site, they don't know anything about master pages. They just see a completed web page. Because remember, the whole idea of server-side scripting is at the end of the day, what gets delivered to the client? A web page, an HTML page. So parts of this HTML page came from the master page. This came from the master page. This came from the master page. This did. This stuff comes from the specific page. So that's pretty much what we did last time. Are there any questions on that? And then we actually made a bunch of these. We made 4 of them. All right. Each of these specific pages has a declaration at the top saying what the master page is for it. All right. So when you choose a master page, that's what you get. All right, let's go and make a nested master page. And let's say that there are certain pages on our site, maybe product pages. Let's call our product pages. All right? That has something on the right side of the screen. So if we're looking at this, we can say that these pages, in addition to these areas in common, these special products pages, or sale products we'll call them, have something over here as well. All right, and all the pages in that group of pages have that in there. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new master page. File, new file, and I'm going to create a master page. Now, when you create a master page, you are also asked the question, do you want it to be based on a different master page? So in this case, we're going to take the master page that we created last time and extend it and make a more specialized version. We're going to nest master pages. So, I'm going to select that master page. And I'm going to build the master page based on my original master page. Now, when we do that, it is just like any other page that we inherit from a master page. That is, we get the two content placeholders that were defined. So we get a content placeholder for head, a content placeholder one, where we could put content in. Now in this case, what I want in my content tag is I want another content placeholder. And I'm going to give it a totally distinct name just so that CSS-wise it doesn't get confused. We'll call it content placeholder 3. And then I'm going to put an aside tag that maybe represents a coupon or something that we want to have on the sale product master page. Again, this would be any content that you would want on a certain subset of pages in a certain section. So now we can look at that. All right. That's not exactly right. No, it's in the placeholder.
I know, but shouldn't there be an end content?
Yeah, there is at the end of the line. So yeah, there was one. Problem is, I haven't done anything stylized with this. That's why it's appearing there. So what I can do is I can go into the CSS file and I can style it. Now I can take two approaches, there's probably more than two approaches I could take. I could take a bunch of different approaches for this. And the good news is more or less any of these approaches are gonna be about the same. So you almost can't lose here. I could put style for this in my original style sheet, right? Because if you have style for something in your style sheet and a page doesn't happen to have that element, there's no harm. It's not like you get an error or something. So I could put code in for an aside, or I could put code in for an ID or something like that, and it would work, all right? Or, remember, I have a place to put stuff in the head of any of the pages that inherit from this. So I could either put a second style sheet to style that in. I could create a second style sheet to just style the stuff that's distinct to this page. Or I could actually put the CSS code in here. What's the difference? Well, one, I'm putting the code right in. I'm putting the style code right in here. And you might say, well, I thought we learned not to do that. I thought we learned to create external style sheets. We did, but why did we learn to create external style sheets? Because we wanted all the code to be in one place. Well, if we put it in a master page, then all the code will be in one place. So it's just a matter of whether it will be as part of the master page or as part of a secondary CSS file. So what I'm going to do is, just for variety, why not? You certainly don't have to do it this way, but just to sort of demonstrate, I want to put the style right in this master page, all right? Which again, is okay, because this code is still only going to be in one place. You know, remember the reason why we do things. You know, it's not like I'm how do I want to say it? It's not like the reason that external style sheets are better is because that puts all the style code in one place. Well, if I put it here, it's going to be in one place anyhow. So I can go in and I can say aside with 10%. Float right. And that moves a coupon to the right part of the screen. All right. So, again, I did that through style. I could have put that code in another CSS file if I wanted to, or I could have included that in the original. All right. Now I'm going to go and I'm going to create my sale product page, or pages. I'll just do one of them. All right. So I'll go in and I'll say file new. File, go create a web form, and I'm going to call it sale product, sale product. I'm going to say select master page, place code in a separate file. Now I'm going to pick the second master page. By the way, you should be more descriptive in your file names than I was in this example. I just called it master page and master page 2. I should probably have called the first one something like main master page and the second one like sales product master page, because that's what that represents. Anyhow, I go and do that, and now I get, notice I only get the content placeholder that was on the second master page. So if I wanted something in the head, I would have had to put it in the master, in the nested master page. But now I can put in something like sale product. Now if I look at this, I notice that that pushed the stuff down. Because I don't have any styling for this content area, so I can go and add a style rule for that. That's going to be an ID. Okay, sort of what I wanted, not exactly, but I could fiddle with the CSS to get it to be exactly what I want. So again, this would be then I could create a whole list of sales product pages that all inherited from this master page. And the good news is if I change the original master page, this page will get it. If I change the secondary master page, this page will get it as well. All right, so you can nest those master pages. Typically done with larger projects where you have sections of the page that have some common content that other sections of your site don't have. All right, so I could go and add this sales product to my main master page in the navigation. all my pages will get it. The ones that inherit from the first master page and the one that inherits from the second master page. Why? Because that second master page also inherits from the first master page. So if I go and run this now, that new thing I added in the navigation is there. And if I go to other pages, it's there as well. Whoops. Except I called the name wrong. I think I said, yeah, sale product, not sales product. So I can go there, I can go there. This one, remember, the code for this comes from three places. The original master page, that second nested master page, and then finally the page itself. So this stuff comes from the master page, the main master page. This comes from the secondary master page, and this comes from the page itself. Whereas this page, this stuff comes from the first master page, this comes from the page itself. All right. There is another thing that we can do that helps with the navigation. All right. And we're going to do this in a couple of steps. We're going to create the ASP.NET controls for it manually by typing in the names of the pages and the links and all that. And then we're going to build a sitemap, all right, a sitemap XML file. So I'm going to go to my master page, and I'm going to get rid of my navigation. I'm just going to delete it. And I'm going to put in, I have two choices. I have a tree view and a menu. And we'll do both of these. All right? We'll do both of these in the navigation. All right? Normally, you'd only have to do one, right? I mean, you don't need two navigations. But to demonstrate the difference between the two, I'll do them both as part of the same navigation. So I'm going to drag the menu over. All right, and then what I can do is I can click on this, and I have choose data source, which we're not going to use now, but we will use when we develop a sitemap XML file. But I can click on edit menu items, and I can manually edit this. And this is going to be very similar to what we did with the dropdown. All right, so I can click on edit menu items, and I can start adding stuff. So I can add homepage, and I can put the navigate URL here, which is default.aspx. I can add another root item. Root item means it's on the first level. And I can say locations, and I can pick the navigate URL. I can add another root item for products. Now, my next thing I'm going to do, sales products, if you think about it, logically are sort of a subset of products, right? So I'm going to make that a child of products. We're going to do this because we're going to have a collapsible menu. And I'm going to add a couple of pages here, even if I don't actually go and create the pages. I'm going to add a couple links here. But, for example, I can have sale products. I can add another child, and maybe this is cheese. I'm not going to actually make that page, but just for demonstration purposes, maybe I add another sale, another item for cookies. So let's say those are the three items underneath products. Notice that I added them as child or children. So they're underneath products in the hierarchy. Then finally, I'm going to end up by adding a contact us. And I'll put the URL in, which is contact us. Now when I run this, notice what I get menu-wise. Alright. I get those three links, but this one that I have children underneath gives me sort of a pop-up menu. So I can easily go and then pick sales products and get to that page. Or I can go back to products or whatever. So that's a menu control. Alright? You go in and you put things in and you can enter things as children. And the good news is that you could have as many different children as you want to and it will just keep adding menus on. So, for example, if I went here, and maybe under cheese, there was a child for Swiss cheese. Do that. I always hit OK to close it. And maybe there's another one for American. And again, what we'll do is we'll get the menus with the mouse over effects. So under products, if I pick cheese, whoops, I get that menu popping up. All right. Now, we can orient this menu a couple different ways. And we can also designate a few different properties of this. First of all, I could make this, let me see if I can find these attributes. Be oriented vertically or horizontally. If I make it be oriented horizontally, I'd have to change my style sheet for that. But it could extend the width of the page. So it could be oriented vertically like that. And now when I run it, I get the menu items like this instead of the way that they used to be. I can also choose things like how long they disappear after. So in other words, I could make the menus disappear immediately. I think they give me 500 milliseconds, which is like half of a second. So I could really make it disappear after a long time. Let's go in and put 10,000 milliseconds. So if I put my mouse over that and move it, it'll stay there for 10 seconds before it disappears. Or 10 years or whatever 10,000 milliseconds is. Every 10 seconds. Alright. So you can make it disappear quickly, or you can make it disappear after a while. Again, remember, when you're doing code like this, you're using built-in stuff in the framework. So be very hesitant to reinvent the wheel. Alright? You could write code to do this. But why bother when you have a nice configurable control that you can go in and use to use to implement that functionality? It's been tested. It will do things in a consistent manner. All right. Now, I'm going to go and I'm going to put a second navigation on this page. Normally, you won't have two navigations on the page. You may have a navigation and a sub-navigation, but normally you won't have two main navigations. But I'm going to do that just to demonstrate using the other kind of control. And that is a tree view. All right? Simply put, a tree view is like the kind of view that you get in certain options of Windows Explorer, or at least you used to. Yeah, not really. Never mind. So I'm going to go in, I'm going to create a second nav section on this page. And I'm going to do the rarest of rare things for myself. I'm actually going to comment my HTML code. Navigation section, I'm going to put a tree view. Alright, let's go and edit that. And I can edit nodes, and I'm just going to create a few nodes. I'm not going to necessarily do all of them, but I do want to create a couple of levels. So I'll go and click Add One, and this will be the home page. And do locations. Then I'll do products. And I'll add a child underneath that for sale products. Whoops, I didn't want to do that. wanted to click that and click child. If you get things on the wrong level, you can use these guys to move it over to the right or to the left. So I want this to be cheese. And I would have my... And underneath that, I could have create a child, Swiss. I always do that. And I can put American. So this is most of what I had on the other one, but I don't think quite all of them. But I think it's enough to see what I'm going to do here. Now, how are those two things different? Tree view, I don't think I can orient it horizontally, so it has to be oriented vertically. I don't believe I could do it that way. When I run this, what do I get? I get sections of my navigation that I can collapse or expand. So I can collapse it by pressing the minus sign, and I can expand them by pressing the plus. Now what's the difference? Here it does about the same thing, but as I move my mouse out, it disappears. Remember, I have a really long timeout for that, 10 seconds, so it will disappear eventually. All right. Whereas here, it will go, and it will be... I can collapse them or hide them. Now, what if I want to only show initially a certain number of them? I can do that by, again, setting properties. The question of how do I do something, how do I configure it to make it behave differently than the default, is almost always a question of what property do I want to change. So in this case, what property do I want to change? There is a property for how many levels I want to show. I think that's it. And I can say I only want to show one level, or I want to show zero levels. And again, remember, us in programming, zero's actually kind of one, you know, shows the top level, all right? I can still expand it, but when I first go to the page, it will show only the top level. I go to another page, only shows the top level. And I can expand and hide, and it'll show the stuff underneath it. Really, difference between the two are that the menus can be oriented horizontally or vertically. The tree is, to my knowledge, only vertically. Kind of doesn't make sense when you think about it horizontally. I suppose you could probably come up with something, but tree is typically oriented vertically. The menu, the sublevels are shown and hid based on putting your mouse over them. With the tree view, the submenus are shown and hidden based on clicking a node. If you click a node and it has children, if you click the little plus sign next to it, it will expand it. If you click the little minus sign, then it will contract it again. All right, questions about that? All right. Last thing we're going to do, and we won't do it all today, but we'll start on it, all right, is we're going to do our first case of what's called data binding. Now, what is data binding? Data binding is where you sort of marry two things together. Data binding is where you have data that comes from one place and a visual representation of the data in a different control. So far, whenever we've had controls that have data, like drop-downs or radio buttons or the menu control or the tree view, we've gone and we've typed in the data manually. So for example, I wanted to edit this tree control. I went to edit nodes. And I manually go and type in all the different nodes. So the data is part of that control. This is not data binding. This is building the control with the data that you need in it. Data binding is where, for example, maybe our list of options don't come from some hard-coded list, but maybe they come from a database. All right? If you think of a drop-down for a particular value might actually be getting the data for the drop-down from a database. So if you wanted to search for classes by department, for example, on a college's website, you would expect whatever departments were in that college would appear in the drop-down. And if they go and add a new department to the college database, you would expect that department to now be in the drop-down. So in that case, we have two things. We have the visual representation of the data, and then we have the data source, where the data comes from. In a very short period of time, that is next week, all right, our data sources, or possibly Thursday, I guess it depends how it goes, but our data sources are going to be databases. So we're going to put things in databases and we're going to then visually represent them on our web pages, all right? Until then, though, in our first example, we are going to be pulling data from an XML file. All right? We're going to be pulling our data for an XML file, or from an XML file, and we're going to populate two different things. All right? Again, the idea of pulling out something so that it only lives in one place is something that's always a winning concept in any kind of programming. So, here's the two things that we're going to be doing, and we're going to use an XML file for it. We are going to put on our page breadcrumbs. I think in the correct ASP.NET terminology, they call them a sitemap path. What is a sitemap path? It shows the user how they got to the place that they've got to on the website. So, for example, if you were on the Swiss cheese page in our example, it would show home, products, cheese, Swiss, because that's the path that the user took to get to it. If you remember what our menu was like, our menu had home. I'm going to change it a little bit to have products indented underneath home. Actually, we have a few other things here too. We had home, location, products, sale products, cheese, Swiss, American. Then we had contact us or something like that. So let's say is our navigation. On the top of the page shows the path that the user took to get there. So in other words, off the home page there's a product page. Off the product page there's a cheese page. Off the cheese page there is a Swiss page. So that's the path that the user took to get there. If they were on the location page, it would simply show home, location. Breadcrumbs or sitemap paths are valuable because it sort of shows the user how they got there. So if the user doesn't find what they're looking for, they can sort of easily retrace their steps. Now you can use the back button to be sure, but if you've clicked and gone down a bunch of menus, sometimes it's useful to use the breadcrumbs to get back to where you were looking or what you were looking for. Now, if you think about it for a second, this and this better be consistent. Could you imagine if your navigation said one thing and your sitemap path said something else? That'd be really confusing for the user. In addition to that, remember, our goal as programmers is to put stuff only in one place. All right? And therefore, if this and this really come from the same data, we shouldn't have to duplicate any effort. We shouldn't have to do something to show the sitemap path and something else to do the navigation. So, what are we going to do? Well, we're going to find a place to put the information about how our site is structured. And that place to put it is going to be our sitemap XML file. So, we're going to create a sitemap XML file. And then we're going to bind both of these controls to the same sitemap XML file. So, what do we have? If I add another page to my site, I add it to my sitemap XML file, instantly this is adjusted to reflect this, and this is adjusted to reflect this. All right? So much of what we do in this class, if you think about it, so much of what we do in programming is taking something and finding just one place to put it, so we don't have to worry about changing it twice. All right? Or if we change the way that things are indented, maybe we put sales products on the same level as products or whatever. Or we add an extra category, European cheese and North American cheese or something like that. Any change that we make to the sitemap file will get reflected here and it will get reflected here. All right, so we'll keep that consistent. Now, we probably have all heard the term XML file before. Have we all heard the term XML file? Okay. What is an XML file? Of storing data. Alright? And data could be stored a bunch of different ways. In the old days, data was stored in what were called flat files. A flat file is just where you just simply have rows of data. It would be like a spreadsheet. What's distinct about an XML file is that you can store the data and you can store the structure of the data. You can store the hierarchy of the data. Let's say, for example, we were doing an XML file for a library. All right? We were representing some kind of data about books in a library. So we have Edgar Allan Poe, and he wrote The Raven and Telltale Heart. And we have William Shakespeare. He wrote Hamlet and Romeo and Juliet. And Julius Caesar. And a bunch of other stuff. Alright. There's a hierarchy in this data, right? All these things aren't conceptually on the same level. If we were making an outline of authors and their works, these things belong to Edgar Allan Poe. These things belong to Shakespeare. Alright? So that's a hierarchy. It matters the way that they're indented. Alright? You can do that in XML. You can't easily do that in the old days flat files. In the old days of flat files, you had to write special code to get that sort of hierarchy. But with XML, you can easily show that these pieces of data belong with this, these pieces of data belong to this. XML stands for Extensible Markup Language. What else have we seen that is a markup language?
HTML.
HTML stands for Hypertext Markup Language. HTML is a special purpose markup language. It's a language that we use to define web pages. XML is a format that we can use to define any data, provided, and we can exchange data between parties, parties being different applications and so on, provided that both parties know the rules of the particular XML data. All right? Now, in the case of, and how do we show in HTML, for example, that a certain piece of code is in the navigation section? So we had a set of links that were in the navigation section a few minutes ago. How did we show that these links were part of the navigation section?
A beginning and end.
We nested those tags. So we can do the exact same thing with XML. We can nest tags. So, XML is also a markup language. By markup language, it means we use tags. The X stands for extensible, which means that we can use it for any kind of purpose, not just for HTML, not just for defining web pages, but defining any kind of data, provided everyone knows the rules of how that data is stored. So, I could make an XML file that would look like this, that would represent this data.
This would be an XML representation of the data that I just described a few minutes ago. How do we know that Hamlet was written by William Shakespeare in this? Because Hamlet is part of the author tag for William Shakespeare. It's nested underneath that. So we're showing a hierarchy. So that's important to note. With XML files, we can easily show hierarchy simply by nesting them. So we can nest these tags to show hierarchy. So what are the books that Edgar Allan Poe wrote? Well, they're the titles that are underneath his name. And we could add other attributes. Notice how these are like HTML tags. They have starting and ending tags. We can nest tags, and the tags have attributes. So author, name equals Edgar Allan Poe. I could have other attributes there. The date he was born, the date he died, where he was born, and so on. I could have different attributes for the title tag. I could have, the year that it was originally published, for example. Or if it's a library, like what the number is, where it's on the shelf, or whatever. Those could be attributes, or those could be separate tags, depending on how we wanted to do that. So the idea here is that we're going to show some data, and we're going to show the structure, the hierarchy of the data. Well, let's get back to our navigation here. In our navigation, if you remember, we had, and I wish I didn't erase that. Notice we had a books tag at the start and end. That's another key to an XML file. There's always one thing that's called the root node. That's like everything is within one tag, all right? And you have that in HTML, right? Everything is within the HTML tag. Well, you also have that in XML. Everything is in the root tag. So let's consider the data we want to store for our sitemap, all right? Our navigation. Our navigation has its home page. It has a locations page. It has a products page. It has a sale product page. It has a cheese page. Underneath the cheese page is Swiss and American. And then underneath, at the same level as this, is a contact us page. I think that's all the pages. If not, we're going to pretend that it is. Now, there's only two tags we need to worry about with the sitemap XML file. First one is the sitemap tag itself. So the sitemap tag is the root tag for sitemaps. It goes around everything. The other tag that we have is we have a sitemap node. So in our case, each one of these is going to be represented as a sitemap node. Now the sitemap node could be a web page, or it could be simply a section of web pages. Like maybe we don't have an actual cheese web page, but we want to categorize these two under cheese, so we put that in. All right, so how would this look? We're going to have a sitemap node. We define, for each sitemap node, we define a URL, which will be default.aspx. We define a title, which we could call the home page. And we define anything else. Oh, a description, if we want to have a description. Now, here's something I'm not too crazy about. But there has to be one homepage and only one. Every other page has to be underneath this sitemap node. So I'll have a sitemap node for location, a sitemap node for product, and in between the sitemap node for product, we'll have one for sale product, one for cheese. Within that one, we'll have one for Swiss and one for American. So we're going to nest these sitemap nodes in a way that's going to mimic the way that they're nested on our navigation. So let's go and at least start this. We're not necessarily going to get all of it done. Let me look at the time. But we'll at least start this, and we'll finish this up on Thursday. So I'm going to put my root, my home page, I'm going to put default.aspx. The title is going to be home. Underneath that, we have location. And the title, I'll make location. And I'll just do contact us for now. And we'll fill in the nesting next time. So now I have a mini sitemap. I don't have everything, but I have some of it. What can I do with this? Well, I can do this. I can go back to my master page. And I'm going to choose data source. In other words, where is the data going to come from to do this? It's going to come from a new data source. What kind of data source is it? It's a sitemap. All right. I can also go and I can put in my second nav section, I'm going to put a sitemap path. So now when I run this, I can expand that. I can see the two pages that are underneath it. My sitemap path says I'm on the home page. I can click location. And my sitemap path says home location. That's how I got there. So my navigation is now tied to my sitemap file, as is my sitemap path. We'll finish up here today. Next time we'll go in and we'll add the tricky part, the nesting part, so that we can have sort of a hierarchy that mimics a hierarchy of our website. All right, we'll see you over in lab.